Dalton? I can hear Dalton. Can you hear the Dalton?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yes, we can both hear Dalton. Auto cue. The car is set. Seconds counting down the water.
Yeah, 60 seconds.
60 seconds. I don't know where.
1 minute, yeah.
Good evening. You're watching Outside the Box, the show that gives you the opportunity to interact with political party candidates. As earlier mentioned, all registered parties have been invited to be part of this show. To our daily poll now, yesterday's question was, should the housing assistance scheme continue after the elections? 73.33% voted in the affirmative, while 13.33% disagreed. Today's question is, should the cost of living adjustment or COLA payment system be reintroduced? Text your answer, a simple yes or no, to 3592. The poll is opened to Vodafone, Digicel and Inc. users. Charges apply. Now, Mr. Takenana from the People's Democratic Party was supposed to be also joining us tonight, but he'll be appearing on our show next Monday. But joining us tonight on the show is Semesa Karavaki, and when it comes to elections, not many understand the mechanics of the polls as he. Bula, Mr. Karavaki, welcome to the show.
Bula, Mr. Long.
No, you were a former supervisor of elections. Would you have conducted the election in a different way?
Given the shortage of time that we have to prepare for this election, and to take into account that there are many, many ways to prepare for elections, I would prefer to use numerators, you know, to send out to house, where they are to reach the people from their houses, because we need to get as many people as possible to be on the voters list. And if we don't, most of these people will not exercise their right to vote.
This is about more than 500,000 people that have registered to vote, close to 600,000, I guess. Is that enough?
That's still not enough. You know, there are many people as we go out there, they listen to us at where we go to meet them. Most of them have not been registered, and that when they want to go to register in the last minute, but it was too late.
But they were given time.
That's still not enough. It is the role of the government to do as much as possible, to do their best, you know, and not just to let the people decide for themselves. They have to do all what they could possibly do, you know, to get the people to be on the roll.
Right. Now, Mr. Karavaki, you are a new phase in politics. What do you think is really the key issue of these elections?
You know, as we read in the newspapers, Mr. Long, we see and we hear everywhere the issues about land and the issues about religion. And although we have the bread and butter issues, but those bread and butter issues, they all link up to these major issues.
What particular about land?
In particular about land, Mr. Long, you know, when you do not allow consultation with the landowners and you exercise unilateral decision to acquire their land or to make laws to control the use of their land without a meaningful consultation with the landowners.
Are you referring to a particular issue here about land?
You would be aware of the land use decree. The land use decree, although it says from the early sections of the decree that the decree, that law is supposed to be for the benefit of the landowners,
but it
actually not.
One of the main objectives of the land decree, which establishes the land bank, is to find investors or lessees to lease indigenous land.
That's right. You see, what the government is putting the emphasis on now is the emphasis is on the investors. There are less emphasis on the landowners because they do not allow landowners under the decree even to challenge, you know, any decision that had been made for the leasing of their land once the land has been leased by the investors. So the emphasis that the government is putting on land is basically to the economy, to the investors, but they don't really, really care about the landowners.
Right. Now, the objective of the land bank, if I may refer to that earlier, was, you know, government to find people to lease or investors to lease the land. Do you think, you know, the same intention there could have been done within the TLTB?
Of course, exactly. I do not know why they have to establish a new unit apart from the ITLTB, because that could have been done under the ITLTB. So we ask the question why it did not happen. Because eventually, in using that new unit, all the land that will be taken to that new unit would come from the control of the ITLTB. So in doing that over time, you know, years to come, so there will be a decline in the land being administered by the ITLTB, say about 90% or 91% of the land in Fiji are native lands. Mm. So the land under the ITLTB will eventually be taken out and put into a new unit. So eventually over time, ITLTB will have no more land to look after.
Is the security of land, indigenous land, a question now?
Of course.
In what way?
The security is very much a big issue now, because the right of ownership of indigenous people over their land is now being relegated to come under the rights of individuals under the Constitution. You know, it's so sad when they raise this Constitution, when they hold this Constitution up and they say it's the best Constitution ever made in this country, but it's not. See, this Constitution has relegated the rights of the indigenous owners over their land to be subjected to individual rights. This is under Chapter 2, under the Bill of Rights, over here. Especially I'm talking about Section 26. See, the application of the Section 26...
Could do the caller first. There's a call on the line. We'll go to that after. Okay. Kishore on the line from Sigatoka Bula. Mr. Kishore, go ahead.
Yes. Good evening, gentlemen.
Go ahead,
My question to the candidate is that, I mean, he's saying that under this new constitution, the protection of the land is not there. See, what about the land bank? See, in the initiative of the land bank by this current regime, it has given the indigenous right as well, and the indigenous rights are giving having this royalties over that land bank issues. You know, suppose if the land is not used, and then where this indigenous, the native people going to get their revenue from? Now, from this you can see that the land has been used, the Matangali are getting their resources and the revenue from. If you're going to not use this and utilize this land, where are you going to get this revenue from?
You see, Mr. Lawler, this is the argument that always comes on the other side. See, look, you cannot overtake the right of ownership by the economic issues. Economic issues is there, but it's subject to the ownership of land.
And that's been lost.
Yeah, that has been lost.
Under Section 1.
If you take away the ownership of land, you take away the rights to make decision on the land. And you're saying, why do you care about it? Because you will have money if that is taken away from you.
Under what section that right has been taken away?
Section 26. Mm. Section 26 of the Constitution, it says that the government, or there can be any law made, there can be any administration over, right, over any affairs about the ownership of land, mm, about the ownership of Ngolongolo, and about the chiefly title.
Time is up, but just quickly, if you can summarize that very quickly.
Yeah, and you see the ownership of land by the Fijians, the communal ownership, they're being subjected to the individual rights.
Right.
So if there is a lease by somebody,
yeah,
and the lease had expired. This expired under that chapter 2, right, you know, the Bill of Rights. They have the rights to housing.
Yeah.
You know, to have the right of housing, the government has the right to use that, so that those people, yeah, claim that part of the land and will never move away from it.
Thank you, Mr. Karavaki. Stay with us. Joining us next is Rupeni Silimaibau from the Fiji Labour Party. Welcome back. Join our discussion live tonight by texting in your questions 35599 or call our studio line 330-2100. And remember, you can have your say in our daily poll. The question is still, should the cost of living adjustment, the COLA payment system, be reintroduced? Simply text us a note 3592 to all Vodafone, Digicel and Inc. users. Rupeni Silimaibau from the Fiji Labour Party now joins the discussion. Mbulasa, welcome to the show.
Bulamanaka Mika and Bulamanaka to all the viewers who will be watching the program tonight.
Now, you once joined the SDL, and they even made you one of the councillors during the term in government. Why the sudden change to Fiji Labour Party?
Thank you, Mika. The change to the my stance in Fiji Labour Party is basically on the dissolutions of the SDL party. I think there are no SDL party at this stage. The party that is contesting the election right now is called
SODELPA. But they still exist as SODELPA under a new name.
Under a new name, but it's a new administration altogether. And also on that, if I had decided to join Fiji Labour Party, basically because of the policies that they have currently in place, promoting the interests of the workers and also championing the interests of the poor who are living in our society.
So your opinions that were once with the SDL then has changed now? On certain issues?
It's only on a few certain issues, especially on the issues in relation to the workers' rights.
Now, there's a question by one of our viewers, texting just a short while ago. Why does your party support the return of the GCC, the Great Council of Chiefs?
Basically, the support in terms of the GCC is basically on the recognitions of the party in relation to the chiefly systems that we are having in Fiji. And they always respect the chiefly arrangement that is already in place, which is intact in our traditional setup. And for so many years, and in previous years, Fiji Labour Party always support and recognize the GCC. And that is basically why I believe that the GCC, Fiji Labour Party, will continue to support.
Another question from our viewers tonight, what will your party do to improve the livelihood of tenants who are currently with the TLTB?
there is a lot of strategy that can be put in place. If you look in through the party manifesto, you will definitely see that there is clear statements on UCV that we will be increasing to 10% of the UCV, and there should be a strategy that will be put in place to see to ensure that there is a fair treatment to both the landowners and the tenants.
Now you mentioned fair treatment of that to the both the landowners and the tenants. On UCV, 10% of UCV.
Yep.
Now, past research have shown that calculations under that, if, for example, $100 lease money, 80% will go to the tenant, 20% will go to government, 2% will go to the landowners. How can that be fair to the landowners under that calculation of 10% of UCV?
I mean, based on that 10% calculation, I think the party will look into to review the current policy that is in place. You need to give a fair distribution to the landowners as well.
Okay. There's Netani from Lami on the line. Netani Mbulabinaka, go ahead and ask your question. Okay, it's gone, Mr. Silimaibau. You go back to the GCC. Your party is wanting to bring that back. It's not in the 2000 Constitution, and there's a provision, and we all know it's common knowledge that no one can change the Constitution, current one, overnight. I mean, how can you do that if you come into government?
Well, it's also in the Constitution. There is a process that needs to be followed. You need to have 75% representatives in government, in parliament, and that will give you the rights to change the Constitution, and there will be a national
referendum. How soon your party will do that if it gets into power? In the first year?
The better, the sooner the better.
Sooner the better.
Yeah.
Tell us the timeline, to be exact.
Yeah, that's I can commit on that one, the sooner the better.
The sooner the better?
Yes.
Okay, right. Now, you once a national coordinator for provincial youth, right? Forum for the Fiji Islands. You know, about 50% of the voters of this election are youths. Yep. What best can you give them in these elections?
There is a lot of things that I'm having in mind, especially for the youth in Fiji. I've been working for the Provincial Youth Forum for the past 9 or 10 years, and I've seen a lot of issues coming from youths, and that is not something that is new to me. That is why if you look into our manifesto, you will see that we've got the National Services Scheme program that we will be introducing when we are in government, basically to address all those issues in relation to youth unemployment. If you look into the Provincial Youth Forum composition and the membership of the Provincial Youth Forum, these are the youth organizations which are based in rural areas, and their interest is more on the better utilization of our resources. And if you look into the Fiji Labour Party manifesto, you will see that the party has come up with agriculture estates in order to encourage and empower rural youths to better utilize their land, and the government will subsidize and also will supplement the cost of the initial inputs,
right.
Subsidizing cost of fertilizers, and there will also be a special fund which we will be setting aside in order to encourage youth participation in self-employment, to create self-employment.
So, there's a call on the line. Bulubinakola, go ahead and ask Mr. Silimaibau your question.
Good evening. My name is Yalo. I'm from Suva. My question to the gentleman is, if you come power and coalition with SODELPA, what are the issues of commonality would you have? Thank you.
There's a lot of issues that we are having in common, especially on, like what I've stated earlier, we are having issues in common in terms of workers' rights. We also have issues in terms of the retirement age. If you look into that issues, both the political parties, both parties, they are planning to revert back the retirement age to 60. Apart from that, we've got common issues in the GCC. Both of them are supporting that idea and that ideology in recognizing and respecting the chiefly setup of our nation. And there are so many other things, especially in addressing housing. I think there's a lot of needs that needs to be addressed in terms of rental from various tenants in the public rental board. They are currently paying $92. I've just heard this when I did my campaign in Rewai, and there's a big challenge. They've been calling housing authority.
Right. Okay, Mr. Mimbao, there's a question again for you. Will your party review the salaries of the disciplined forces if it comes into power?
The disciplined forces, as in our manifesto, we will be looking into Fiji Police Force. There is a certain percentage that need to be reinstated. And the reviewing of the salary for disciplined forces, it's not only, I mean, we don't have to specifically see this disciplined forces. We'll have to review.
You mentioned the police.
The police is the reinstatement.
Military, what about the other disciplined forces?
The other disciplined forces, I think they have been addressed. All those salaries have been addressed, as in the military. They've already implemented that review.
Okay. Maybe a final question to you. If your party wins, how can it repay back the loans from overseas?
There's a lot of strategy that we are having in place. We'll need to revive the industry at the industrial level. Just look into the sugar industry in terms of production. There's a reduction, 50% reduction in terms of volume, the production that we are producing. Yeah, and if you're looking into the copper industry, once we used to produce 45,000 tons of copper, now we are producing only 6,500. We need to revitalize, revive the industry at industrial level. That is where the money will be coming in.
So that's how your party will solve it. Maybe my last question to you, do you think youths will vote for you in this election?
They should vote for me because of my past experience with
them. All right, good. In our final segment, we speak to Seini Nabou from the National Federation Party. Welcome back. Remember, you can join the discussion live by texting in your questions to 3599. My apologies. Or call our studio line 330-100. Joining us now is Seini Nabou from the National Federation Party. Good evening, Ms. Nabou. Welcome to the show.
Thank you. Nico.
Now, you were a political advisor to Greenpeace before deciding to take up politics. Why? Why?
Why
politics?
Well, taking up politics was not a conscious decision that I aspired to. I had been involved in the backgrounds of politics in regional and international politics, you know, influencing environmental policies. But I was convinced that I had to take a stand if I wanted to in these elections. And because I myself am not a supporter of the coup culture, I decided to start this journey. And of course, getting my family supporting me was important because I'm a mother as well with four children.
So you want to stop the coup culture?
Primarily, yes. I think where we are right now is economically, socially, is an impact of all these regressive coups from 87 till now, and I think it's time to say enough.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And to do that, well, what are some things that you are thinking about doing?
So the NFP has very concise policy ideas in its manifesto. The first one is the need to rebuild the economy. That's a given and is a priority, rebuilding the economy. Then after that cascades things like education, building the intellectual capacity of our people, the next generation. But one of the things that we've pledged to do within the first 100 days is an NFP government will reduce VAT from 15% to 10% to reduce the hardship on our poor people. We'll also reduce tariffs that are unnecessary burden. And then we intend to convene a national forum for our traditional chiefs and heads of our Yabusa so that they can determine themselves things about Fijian administration. Like the Great Council of Chiefs, should it come back? Should the NLTB come back? What should it look like? Is it fit for purpose? And then we will act on it. We don't believe it's appropriate for a government or a political party to dictate, okay, tomorrow we'll bring in the GCC. That's a separate conversation, and the government is just there.
You have a call on the line, Ratish from Ba, Mbulubunaka Ratish. Go ahead and ask your question to our guest.
Bulavinaka Saka. One kere, just a question to my host there. How can we improve the rural economy?
Okay. How can we improve the rural economy?
Okay, one of the other priorities of the NFP government is also to grow the agricultural sector, because 60% of our rural sector depends on agriculture. And we want to diversify things like non-sugar commodities, rice, spices. We want to explore that. We want to explore the supply chain and the production chain, and bring things accessible to market so that people don't necessarily have to flood to the city centers.
But how can you do that when people were supposed to be on that end of those policies? They're the ones that are coming to Suva and are living in squatters.
That's correct. And that's because there are no opportunities out there for them. The standards, this is also linked to other sectors like education. The perception is still that the quality of education in the town centers is better. And we, if you look in our manifesto under education, we are looking at quality education.
Okay.
Yeah.
Right. Now, what is your thought or your party's thought on equal citizenry?
Yes, it's that issue is quite topical. An NFP government on the issue of equal citizenry is that it will provide equal opportunities for everybody, so that a state or the government will, with all its powers at its disposal, does not impose things, policies, laws that favor one over the other.
So
everyone is equal.
So who do you think this equal citizenry favors? Favoring who more than the other?
Okay, it's not to be confused with the land issue. Equal citizenry, the state can only, like, for jobs. We all should have equal access to jobs, not based on an age or your gender. Or we're all equal under the law.
Right.
That's the party view.
Okay. Environmental policies, you were once consulted on that when you were a political advisor on Greenpeace. And what in effect, I mean, if you look at our environmental policies of the country, is there anything, do you think, can be improved?
A lot. A lot of development is taking place right now. Development is good, it's necessary, but we don't believe that it should be at the expense of those who depend on the environment in the first instance. And therefore, an NFP government will make sure that for any national development projects, it will be guided by free, prior, and informed consent.
Okay.
Because we do not want to see what is commonly known as development aggression.
Right. Now we have Lindia from Wenbokasi on the line. Mbulubunaka Lindia, go ahead and ask your question. Lindia, Mbulubunaka.
Oh yes, Mbulubunaka to you guys this afternoon. My question is, with the current law that we have in place now and the constitution that say that you cannot change the constitution overnight, how can an NFP implement, or what is the time duration that NFP can change all these manifestos that they're coming up with?
Okay, first of all, because of this constitution that has been imposed on us, we have to abide by the rules that have been set. If we are things that we want to change, it's very clear there that it needs 75% of parliament and as well as 75% referendum by the registered voters. So that is a hurdle in itself. But if an NFP government comes into place where we have a majority of 26%, we are confident based on our record of being able to invite dialogue and consensus and get the necessary 37 members of parliament to do what the people want us to do.
Okay, thank you, Ms. Nabou. And that's the show for tonight. Tune in again tomorrow to view the results of our poll. Remember, you can still text in your answers. The question line will be open until 6 p.m. tomorrow. Again, the question is, should the cost of living adjustment or COLA payment system be reintroduced? Text in your answer, yes or no, to 35592. Join me again tomorrow as we continue our extensive coverage heading into the elections. Good evening. Thank you.